Welcome back to the Blue Door Pop Leonard. If you had another bull with Andy Carlson, Minnesota's 87 Best Daily Podcast, a show about everything and nothing, coming right at your ass 5 days a week. Tell a friend, spread the word, add to the Dromey Homie Army, iTunes, Stitcher, iHeartRadio. Sitting in is Uncle Nick. Follow him on Twitter, Nickson. Hey, how's it going?
Hey, going good today.
Should people add you on Snapchat?
Yes.
I feel like that's a bad idea.
I send very appropriate snaps to my storyline. You know, obviously Snapchat's used for a lot of private stuff, and I only send that to a couple of people.
But you receive some inappropriate stuff.
Yeah. I do. I have fans.
Now, randomly, I always pick a song to warm up to, and one of the go-tos is What If God Was One of Us by Joan Osborne, except I do in the voice of that dog meme. What if dog was one of us? I mean, this is a pretty iconic 90s song.
Oh, yeah, it's a big, big hit. I think it must qualify as a one-hit wonder, because I can't think of another Joan Osborne song.
What are you talking about? She had that hit TV show on MTV for a number of years, The Osbournes.
Yeah, I think I got to tell you a little truth about that. It's not about Joan Osborne.
Well, she married Super Dave Osborne, the Vikings running back legend.
No. No, she did not. No.
The song does make me feel good. Make me feel about the 90s.
Queen Essential 90s.
Oh, speaking of quintessential 90s, come on, Spin Doctors. Producer Allie was pissed that you didn't know that it was the guitarist of the band that we were talking about last week that died.
For which one?
I forget.
I don't remember this conversation.
It's like we're talking 90s bands. It was like Collective Soul or something.
Oh, Jim Blossom?
Yeah, must have been Jim Blossoms.
I knew he died. Oh. I only knew like a few years ago that he died. Yeah, it was heartbreaking. Because I told you I'm a big fan of that band and the songs they had. But the business industry is kind of tough, I guess.
Now, the best part about the Spin Doctors is that their lead singer got rickets. So how do you get rickets in America?
It happens.
I understand it happens, except you have money. Like, how do you get rickets if you have money?
Judging by the hat, I can see why I got rickets.
I actually got pretty lucky when I got adopted when I did, because there was another guy who lived in our town that was older, got adopted when he was like 3. I got adopted when 9 months, and he had a lot of health issues. Like he literally had rickets. He had really piss poor eyesight. I don't have great eyesight either, so maybe that's just an Asian thing. And he had issues.
I'm assuming the boat he came on probably had the windows open.
It was a very
time.
Slow boat. Yeah. Oh, here comes the hook. Marry me, I'm the one who loves you, baby, can't you see? I ain't got no future on my family tree, but I'm an everyone who don't want to be. I'm a little bit to love a heart to be said, if you want to call me, maybe. See, like we talked about yesterday, Nick, I'm very good at remembering lyrics. And if you don't remember them, just go, zit-a-deep, da 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 da. Those were the words. Those were the words to the songs by Spin Doctors, and then it got rickets. Oh, speaking of, like, right up your 90s one-hit wonder. How come it's not playing? Oh, there you go. Now, this is one of the first songs you learned to play on guitar, right?
Yeah. You learn in Music 101 that a lot of pop songs follow four chord progression, so you just have to learn four chords, and that's how you can play a song. And Eagle Eye Cherry Safe Tonight is a perfect example of the same four chords being played over and over again, not changing for verse or chorus. It's the same thing. And it's easy.
What do you think Eagle Eye Cherry is doing nowadays?
In this music video, he looks like a butcher. I'm assuming he's a butcher now. A lot of musicians, I mean, I've produced it.
tomorrow I'll be gone, say tonight. Fight the break of dawn, come tomorrow.
Nostalgia is a big part of consumer behavior, and I feel like they should come out with a pop that's called Eagle Eye Cherry. I mean, seriously, like Pepsi, Dr. Pepper should come out with it.
All right, quick question here. All right, let's see your music knowledge here. Yeah. Eagle Eye Cherry, what's his ethnicity? Where was he born? And it's not the answer is not America.
For some reason, I think that he's Asian because I remember the name Eagle Eye is actually his given name. And his dad was like a Vietnam vet. And he gave him the name Eagle Eye because his buddy was named, or nickname was Eagle Eye over there. So I'm going to say, Southeast Asia.
Cherry was born in Stockholm, Sweden.
Oh, so that's complete opposite.
Son of a jazz artist, Don Cherry, and Swedish painter, Monica Cherry.
Wait, so am I confusing Eli Cherry with Tiger Woods? Because I think I might be.
Maybe you are.
Yeah.
He hasn't done any. His Wikipedia page is pretty lacking. He like hasn't done anything since 2000.
Do you think the royalties from one hit is enough to live off of?
If you have a really good record deal, if the contract is written correctly, you know, you could probably live off of one song. Especially this song. I bet to make enough.
Lubega, Mamba Number 5. I don't know, it's a good song, except you don't hear it licensed for any commercials or anything like that.
I feel like so many people play it or sing it, though. I bet a lot of artists use it as
speaking of four chords.
And I'm Benny.
We've been a comedy rock band for close to 40 years now. And all that time, we've never had...
I love this band.
My favorite thing is Australian Jack Black is the main guy here.
A hit.
But you guys know why. Because we never wrote a four-chord song.
What's that? What's a four-chord song, Benny?
Well, if you want all the greatest hits from the past 40 years, just use four chords. Same four chords for every song. It's dead simple to write a pop hit.
Just four?
Yeah, these four. Here. One, two, three, four chords.
Sorry, let me get this straight, Chicken Little. What you're trying to say is you can take those four chords, repeat them, and pump out every pop song ever. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Fuck off.
Yeah, fuck off, Chicken Little.
Just listen. Do you recognize this?
That is Don't Stop Believing by Journey.
It's a great song.
Very original.
There's a few more
song.
That fit. Check it out. My life is brilliant. My love
Stupid
is pure.
James Blunt. Whatever happened to him?
I saw an angel of that old show.
That's just two songs that are similar. That's
forever
not
young.
Three
I
songs.
I want to be forever young. I won't hesitate no more, no more. It cannot wait. I'm yours. This is the way you left me. I'm not pretending. No love, no hope, no glory.
Australian
no
song,
happy ending.
Yeah.
'Cause you were amazing. We did amazing things.
If I could, then I would. I'll go wherever you will go.
They're still together.
Are they?
And he's a woman now.
What?
Yeah, Jordan became a woman.
The fat guy?
Yeah.
No. Mm-hmm. Wait, hold on.
I follow them.
Man. That's cool and all, but really, please tell me he didn't take the name like Jordana.
No, he stuck with the name Jordan.
Oh. Oh, I suppose that could be a female name. Oh, wow. He did. Mm-hmm. Looks pretty good.
Yeah.
Smooth segue. Actually, I have nothing smooth at all about that. But hey, if you're in the market by real estate in the Twin Cities, Josh Pelto, Remax Preferred, you know what it's all about. He is awesome. He's on his own axis. Is awesome. Not really into spicy foods, though. Found that out. Yeah, he tried some jalapeno poppers. Nah, not so much. Not so much. Yeah. But hey, if you're not in a spicy food eating contest, if you're actually buying or selling real estate, your first home, second home, whatever, right here in the Twin Cities, hit up Josh Belto. He knows it. Plus, he stays in communication. He returns calls. I'm sure if you follow him on the Twitter machine or shoot him a DM, he'll DM you back. He'll slide into your DMs. Give him a call, 763-213-4617. One more time, 763-213-4617. Josh Pelto, Remax Preferred, joshpelto.com. How many tacos do you think you could eat in one sitting? We're talking straight up.
Taco Bell tacos? We're talking restaurant tacos?
Soft shell Taco Bell tacos. How many do you think you could eat in? I'll give you 20 minutes.
20 minutes? As in, like, I'm trying to enjoy it, or am I actually trying
to
No,
like a contest. Yeah.
God, maybe 15, maybe? 20?
I could probably do 25.
Okay.
Yeah. Which seems like that's something we should do sometime.
Did you see one of the news things I was trying to send you was Joey Chestnut was just in town in Mystic Lake. Yeah.
The Cinco de Mayo taco eating contest.
Yeah, I think he did more than 20 to 25. I think he like 4 or 5 times that. And okay, you guys all know I'm a glutton. I love eating food. There's a point where like I don't think you would enjoy that food contest in general. The people who do the hot dog eating ones every 4th of July, that the Nathan's one, and just like, it looks like they're in pain and just like it's just, I don't know why, I can't imagine that thing being.
He ate 126 tacos in 8 minutes.
8 minutes?
You broke the world record by 23 tacos.
Okay, one, why is this a record world anything? I who wants to keep track of this? Who goes to elementary school and like, I want to be a fireman. I want to be an astronaut. I want to eat the most tacos in 8 minutes.
Well, you know, the funny thing is, we're going to pull up a clip, is that most of the really good competitive eaters
are just as momentous as sleeping on it.
Your first.
No, most of the like really good competitive eaters aren't what you would think of as someone who's really good at eating. Like Kobayashi is a small, skinny, ripped dude. Joey Chestnut just looks like an average guy. And I was like watching the Nathan's hot dog eating contest where you see the giant 350-pound black dude. He comes in last. It's like, oh, that's the horse I would have bet on. Oh, hey, Rachel Slavik.
Mystic Lake Casino. He's probably better known for eating hot dogs, but last night it was tacos. 12 people in all competed at the World Taco Eating Championship as part of Mystic's Lake Cinco de Mayo celebration. Competitors had to eat as many tacos as they could in 8 minutes. No big surprise here. Chestnut, who is ranked number one, the number one male in the world, ended up winning, but he shattered the world record by eating 103 tacos.
And then he shattered a bunch of other things later.
He ate 126. 126.
That is amazing.
I mean, how...
And disgusting.
Did he dip it in water? I wish...
I don't know. I was wondering that, too. Yeah, because when you do the hot dog bun, you dip it in water, so it's easier to...
I always love local news people, and they're like, oh, wow. Yeah. Vamp.
Because I'm assuming it's not professional to go like Joey Chestnut just ate a record amount of tacos and be like, not that it's going to go like, shit, or like...
See, I wonder if there was some Conolingus enthusiasts who showed up to Mystic who was like, taco eating contest, eh? Oh, Mexican food? Yeah.
I want my money back. some lonely guys showing up and stuff with a box of tissues like, oh, this isn't exactly what I'm thinking.
Speaking of lonely guys, I've been thinking about this for a while. There's a – when people – you can tell on social media, especially on Facebook and Instagram, where they're like a little bit too all in on a relationship, like – if they're putting up posts of the person that they call bae that they've been with for a couple weeks, and then it's like, oh my God, I love you. I couldn't imagine my life without you before you, da da da, blah, blah, blah. I don't know. I always feel like that's a little bit too much. Like, I'm not a love at first sight guy. I'm much more of a, you're trying to dip yourself into a cold pool in the morning. It's not better to just dive right in, just sort of, you know, just inch your way into that pool. I think that's the best way to fall in love, because then you work out the person's idiosyncrasies and you learn to appreciate each other. But the whole going after it hard, falling in lust instead of falling in love, like you tell when they break up in like 10 days that person's going to be catatonic for a month.
Is this like a personal story or something?
No, I mean, it's just a general observation. Like people, when you find your special lady, like I'll tell you, it's like, Nick, it's a bit much.
Nick, you should go to the doctor and get yourself checked out after sleeping with her. You know, I'm a hopeless romantic. I was always, you know, I loved being in, like, when I had my relationships in college, which we won't get into here, but, you know, it's a sweet thing, you know, and a lot of it, I mean, might be overshown by today's television and movies and whatnot. I mean, the entertainment industry have totally blown it out of proportion. You have, you know, obviously, like, you know, with Valentine's Day, the overabundance of stuff. I mean, people think that's probably the norm, but, you know, I think the good relationships, the ones that last, it's the non-overindulgent stuff. It's like, I'm going to be nerdy here. It's like the Star Wars, like, I love you, and then you're just saying, I know. Just the kind of simplicity might be the easiest thing for it.
Yeah, like, I get that maybe movies and the media have sort of glamorized the true nature of love. But, you know, the wife and I, it wasn't like that hardcore falling in love stuff. We just sort of, like, gravitated toward each other. And I think that is the more sustainable version of love, because anyone will tell you, like, once you have kids and a mortgage, it's just as much a joint venture as it is being in love. It's a partnership. You're business partners.
Joint venture.
It is.
That should be an online dating app or something.
Yeah.
You have, like, the OK Cupid. You have the, hey, we're a partnership now.
Yeah. Well, not everything can be the love montage from a movie. You know, a lot of it is nitty gritty, like paying bills or deciding this and that or just killing downtime.
So it's not like that John Bon Jovi song, Living on a Prayer thing, you know?
No. It's I always thought that I love the movies that have like the 90s sort of upbeat songs, one hit wonderish as their love montage. Because, you know, every movie has it where it's like, oh, they're baking bread together and now they're on a date and, oh, the sprinklers went off and, like, oh, they're having such a great time. And yeah. Life is all about that. And there's fleeting moments of that, but I feel like people are being set up for failure when they think that that's all of that. Yeah,
tell me to eat.
Oh, look at them. Oh, they're at the restaurant, and oh, the waiter fudged up the order, but oh, it's okay. But he's allergic to salmon. And then he made her dinner, except he's a bad cook. Oh, but she's still eating it because they love each other. Oh, they got caught in the rain. Well, why is getting caught in the rain romantic, by the way? Getting caught in the rain is a pain in the ass.
It's all wet and moist.
No, everything's not the Notebook.
Everything's the Notebook.
Why did Rachel McAdams fall in love with a guy who can't play defensive back anyways? He was a liability on that T.C. Williams team. He was, yeah. I don't know, like, I feel like the harder that you fall, the harder that you'll fall out of it.
Ooh, interesting.
It's just, it's a little much. Like, also the, I feel having the significant other who's really active on social media, I think that could be bad too. Like, good, bad, or otherwise, your stuff is going to be out there. Like, I'm really lucky. Like, the wife is on, she's not on Twitter or Instagram or Snapchat. Like, she's on Facebook, but she barely uses Facebook. And it's just like, all right, that's cool. But, you know, if she was on there, like, if she was a noted personality, like, if she had more Twitter followers than me, it's like, I feel kind of weird. I think I'm lucky because when I dated crazies, like, there wasn't social media.
Oh, yeah. It's a whole new world out there now compared to, like, how we were when we were starting out.
Yeah.
And I'm in that world now, so when I start dating, I'm going to have to cope with the whole dealing with online social stuff. Like, who's all these followers? on your Instagram. What are you posting? How many likes are you getting on this in your one summer outfit here? I don't like this.
Hey, why is LeBron liking your pictures there, Janice?
Janice.
Yeah, I fully expect the next woman you date is going to be named Janice.
Let's put that out there on social media. Let's see if I can tweet. Let's see if there's anyone named Janice.
No, it's spelled like Janice, except it's pronounced Janice.
Yeah. It's not Janice, it's Janice.
Yeah. So, when you grew up with your cousins, were they primarily your best friends, or did you have like best friends outside of the family?
I had best friends outside the family.
Mm.
Cousins, for the Assumption side, because we were fairly the same age, you know, they were kind of the friends, good best friends. But they, I lived in Roseville. A lot of them lived in Cottage Grove. Mm-hmm. Like far east suburbs near, I think the
Cottage Grove is basically Wisconsin.
Pretty much.
Like, there's no direct way to get out to Cottage Grove.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, so it was a pain. So I didn't see them as often as I did my best friends, and a lot of my cousins on my mother's side, who I consider myself being good friends with them now. You know, growing up as kids, mm-hmm. I was 6 years older than them, so I was more of their
taking a look at my
like
girlfriend.
Babysitter slash, you know, like
yep.
older
lackey,
older authority figure. While these kids were all like. Getting big into Pokemon.
Oh, wait, random aside. So you didn't go out for Cinco de Mayo, right?
I did not, no.
All right. But you picked up one of our friends?
Yes.
What time was this?
12:30.
What time did you go to bed?
After. I fell asleep like I was in bed like at 8 o'clock just sitting up on my computer, social media. Then I got a text at midnight. So yeah. I was just... relaxing for about 4 hours at home. And
So you were lying in bed for 4 hours, but didn't fall asleep?
Yeah.
It seems hard to do.
Oh, yeah. It sucked because I really want to, but I like felt like I had to stay up.
Yeah. If only there's some magic service on everyone's phone that you can get a ride for like $4.
It'd be like 14 probably.
Well, it depends from where to where. In off-peak time... whether we're using Uber or Lyft, I can get downtown for $20. Which is
pretty
sweet because it's kind of a haul.
Oh, I want to see the prices compared to taxis. There has to be something. Yeah. There's something up with us at the fact that Lyft and Uber are so inexpensive. And I've seen websites that say like Uber is like bankrupt, but that's impossible because there's so many Ubers out there still.
Well, there's Ubers out there, except their rates are so low that they're basically cutting their own throat. Like, one of the main drawbacks of Uber is that the fares can't cover their costs. Yeah, they cover their corporate costs, their marketing costs, et cetera, for the app and developers, customer service. And that's why they keep doing so many rounds of investment, is that to cover everything that they can't pay for.
How is that still working, though?
Well, they're running fares that are negatively... they're losing money on every single fare. But by lowering fares, they are shedding competition in all these places because taxi companies, black car services are going out of business. And then it's like what Walmart does. Like Walmart will establish a new store and then have lower prices, undercut all the competition. And then once there's no more competition, all of a sudden, prices go back up.
So maybe a couple years from now when taxi cabs are now like, I know the minority of everything, which they probably are now. I have no idea. I'm not a marketing person. Eventually, Uber is going to be like $30-$40.
That's possible.
Interesting.
Yeah. Like, how come you never became an Uber driver? I feel like you'd be good with that. Or Lyft driver.
The reasons I believe you need a newer car.
You need to not have a felony.
I do not have a felony on my record.
Wait, so when you cash out the brand new Hyundai for a new brand new Hyundai, will you become a Lyft or Uber driver?
I would become one of them. Yeah. I don't know the difference between either or, but I definitely would consider it. I love driving, and I know the Twin Cities a fair amount. You know, I could definitely...
You know the Twin Cities like the back of your hand. Ah, what the hell is that?
Yeah, what's this bowl come from?
Yeah.
I say that... on the kindest words, but there are some drivers. I've had some who seem to have trouble getting out of a parking lot, and you know, you question it sometimes. You know?
Yeah, a lot more. Like I feel like this is completely purely anecdotal, but I've probably taken, I don't know, 100 Ubers or Lyfts in various places, either here or in somewhere else. And it's, I feel like every time it's the foreign driver, they're much better. Like, they maybe they just got here and like they don't know the city very well, except they know how to work the GPS and they don't give an F. The ones I've always struggled are like the gringos. You know, the white boy bros that are they're picking up a couple of shifts on Uber to help pay for their new car.
Yeah. No, that's what I think it is. And like they
suck.
And like I'm sure they know their neighborhood fine, yeah. But when you drive into, you know, like me, I'm from the Roseville area of the Twin Cities. If I had to go pick someone up from Eden Prairie, I would probably get my, you know, I would struggle a little bit just because I'm not familiar with that area.
Hey, man, can I get down Target Field? All right, so where do you need to go in Woodbury?
Yeah. Exactly. Certain stuff like that can be complicated. The foreign drivers, I think they just, they handle the pressure. They can use their Ubers.
Why is that a cliche of the foreign taxi drivers or Uber drivers?
I'm not sure.
Like I forgot. Which show did, or it might have been a movie where our character went over to a foreign country and it was all American taxi drivers. Because like, oh, we have a taxi exchange program.
I don't remember what movie. Yeah.
Would you have more fear being being like a Uber or Lyft passenger or a driver? Like I know some people who don't use ride sharing apps because they're afraid of getting in someone else's car.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. I'm more afraid of, I think, being a driver because you don't know who you're picking up. You don't know.
And they're sitting behind you, man.
I know. It's, I mean, it's a scary risk. I've had a horror story from a friend of mine. She went to an Uber driver.
Yep.
Took her home late at night, and he tried following her into her place. You know, these weird.
Like, with the car?
No, he, like, asked if he could use her bathroom and in her place. And she was like, no. And then he tried following her in after dropping her off. And
that's creepy.
So he, like, you know, she had a, she was able to get away and, you know, call the police.
Coming up on Dateline.
It's scary out there. There's a lot of bad people out there. I mean, obviously there's more good than bad, but it's those, you know, once in a while scary people that kind of, you know, that terrify you from using, a very helpful app. You know, it's better than drinking and driving and getting access, better than trying to find parking. I was in Uptown. I said to pick up my one friend, and there was just so many people in Uptown, and you know, trying to squeeze in and trying to find a off-street parking is ridiculous there.
Well, you know? No, it's pretty easy. You just got to pay $16.
That's not easy, no.
I wonder what the future is going to be. For that, because we're not going back to taxis.
Yeah, I agree. I assume, light rail is being built a lot in the Twin Cities now. I'm assuming they're going to try expanding that.
An app where you can ride share someone else's train. Yeah. hey, man, come and pick me up in Apple Valley. All right, we'll build the train that way. Excuse me, is the train coming soon? Oh, yes, very soon. They're building it now.
I forgot what that was from.
Eurotrip. It's such a great movie. I have this idea, and I don't mind giving ideas because it's all about execution with the idea. Or this can even be a tab on Uber. If you have a truck, just rent out your truck. Because everyone always has a friend with a truck, and if you have a truck, it's a pain in the ass because on the weekends, like, Dave, hey man, hey, can you stop by at like 12:37 tomorrow? We got a couple of couches to move. We'll get you a 6-pack of Strohs. It's like, no, I don't want to do that. It's a nice day. It's the middle of my day. I don't want to help you move. Yeah. Oh, but I have a truck. I'm your friend with the truck.
All right, I have a quick truck story if we have time to tell it.
Yeah.
My brother was living in Madison at the time, and I think this was before my nieces were born. They were him and his wife were living in an apartment, and they bought a new TV.
Mm-hmm.
you know, a little bit bigger one, I think 42 or 50 something.
Now, was this like a flat screen TV or was this still tube TV?
It might have been a tube.
Yeah. Oh.
It was something unusually big.
Yeah.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. That's a lie. I wasn't TV. It was a freezer, you know, like one that you put in the garage, you know, your spare freezer.
Yeah.
And I was driving either my Oldsmobile or maybe I might have gotten my Hyundai by then.
Mm-hmm.
And my brother had a full-size car, and he thought that, you know, if we took it out of the box, we could fit it in his car. We couldn't. And, you know, my brother at the time didn't have a lot of friends in Madison because they just moved out there maybe a year or two before.
Well, how things changed.
Yeah. Ooh, zing. My God, he doesn't listen to this podcast. Anyway, so we bought this freezer, and we had no way of getting it to the house. We went to, and I saw this, was there was a U-Haul down the road from the Best Buy.
Mm-hmm.
We rented a U-Haul truck for $20 to take it 5 miles to their apartment and then drop it off within an hour. And only had to pay like $20 because like their whole introductory rate is like $20 for the first 5 miles or something.
Mm-hmm.
So we were able to like get it to like I think when they put in like a gallon or two of gas in there, and you know, to cover the cost because obviously they checked the whole gauge thing. But yeah, what a pain in the ass just to buy a slightly oversized freezer that wouldn't fit in a full size car. Like we rented something to a U-Haul truck.
Yeah, so the app will be, if you have a truck and you're willing to help someone move stuff, even do some light lifting, yeah. I feel like that could be good to go. Until people use it to dispose of bodies, and then we're out. But I'll have sold the company by then.
I think there'll be a lot of body disposals soon.
Oh, here's your truck.
Americans? Yeah. I love America.
Michelle Trachtenberg.
You just get Miami Vice on television. Hey, man, Miami Vice is number one new show.
Yeah. Listen, we're trying to get to Berlin, Germany. Do you know if there's a train coming anytime soon?
Oh, yes, very soon. They are building it now.
That line always gets me. It's the best. Yeah. Also the best is the second half of the show. Stay tuned. We got more Bull with Andy Carlson on Tuesday. So 2016 sucked for the Vikings and also for a number of other reasons I heard, but it's okay. 2017 is upon us. Vikings fans, let's get going. All offseason, Purple for the Win coming right at you through free agency, the draft, and OTAs and training camp. Here we go. Get the show on 1500 ESPN Podcast One and the Podcast One app. And going back into the Blue Door Pub Thunderdome for a Bull with Andy Carlson on a Monday. And Blue Door, apparently, I did not know this, but I had some knowledge bombs dropped on me last week that the original OG location in St. Paul was called the La Puerta de Azul. And it was like a Mexican bar.
Oh, yeah, I think I remember
thinking
about that.
Which translates into beep, bop, bop, boop, the Blue Door. Crazy. Insane.
That's crazy essay.
You know, for just like a marketing gimmick, every Cinco de Mayo, they should just revert to the Puerta de Azul and, I don't know, do like Mexican blueses or something.
That sounds good.
It'd be good. Hey, Blue Door, get me on your marketing team. Three Twin Cities locations, Longfellow, St. Paul, the OG, and brand new University on Coma. Right now, the Cord on Blue Tachos. Exactly what it sounds like everything that you love about a Cordon Bleu just on top of their award-winning tots. It's good stuff. Visit thebdp.com for more details. Do that up. Nick, what's your favorite, if you had to pick one dish or like one local delicacy, you know, what would you pick?
Local from the Twin Cities here.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Oh, I mean, I love Blue Door to death. It's Lucy's are great.
Mm-hmm.
I do like Shamrock's a lot, though. I think their Juicy Lucy's are pretty awesome as well.
Yeah.
It'd be one of the two. Probably the Cajun Lucy at Blue Door because it's just the right enough spice.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't like too hot of things, but it has just enough heat. Otherwise, Shamrock's, they have excellent Juicy Lucy's too.
Do you think that the Because everyone remembers the Travel Channel, or was it Food Network, one of the two. They did the piece on, who has the best blue sea in the Twin Cities? Is it the 5A Club or Matt's Bar? And then it showed the footage of like these patrons like, Matt's Bar has the greatest blue sea of all time, and I will never step foot in 5A Club. And then you go to 5A Club. Matt stole the idea from the 5A Club. I have zero respect in there. I've never come across any person like that ever. Like I think it was all producers on that segment on that show. I think it was like Burger Paradise or something like that.
No, it's Man Voices Food.
What?
I think it's Man Voices
Food. Oh, no, there's a separate one. Oh,
okay.
Yeah, there's like an original one, which you know, the Travel Channel did like pig out paradises, or you know, those lists of sort of things, or the best place to pig out. I think it was one of those. But yeah, I don't even know people who are militant about a single place in the blue seas. Like, I don't even know anyone who's actually militant about the blue seas. And I know people like to eat.
Yeah, you know, it's all entertainment drama. That's making something out of nothing. Yeah, because, yeah, I mean, you know, we did a fast food thing like a couple weeks ago, and we talked about all the fast foods. Mm. You know, neither of us talked about us being loyalists to one place over another. I mean, you know, like, oh, I love McDonald's, but it doesn't mean I'll never go to Burger King. It's
You'll never go to Burger King because Burger King kind of sucks.
Yes, okay. Yeah, that's a little bit.
But it's not out of blind loyalty. And it's like, hey, we can like multiple Blue Seas from multiple places. You know, I love Blue Door. I love other places' Blue Seas too.
I can see that, yeah.
Yeah. No. Also, I'm not even that diehard into Blue Seas. Just put the cheese on top, man. No, I'm just kidding.
Just put the cheese on top. Yeah. You're getting into dark territory.
It really doesn't matter where the cheese is, to be honest. TBH.
Cheese on the bun.
Blew my mind. Let's do some news.
You are fake news.
Sir,
go ahead.
George Bush doesn't care about black people.
I ain't got time to bleed.
You can't handle the truth.
The news with Uncle Nick.
All right, Nick. What's going on in the world today?
All right. Over the weekend, you know, after Cinco de Mayo was the big thing on Friday, I almost kind of forgot about this this major race. It's the Kentucky Derby happened over the weekend. Usually happens early May, end of April. I completely forgot about it up until like an hour before. Then I'm like, oh, I have to get online to watch the Derby. And kind of lousy weather. The track, I believe, was like soaking wet.
Good.
But in the end, the winner is Always Dreaming.
The thing that I don't like about the Kentucky Derby is that the NBC, bless their heart, turns into a three-hour TV event for, was it 2 minutes?
Yeah, about 2 minutes, I think.
Yeah. It's more annoying than, remember Seacrest, Ryan Seacrest, American Idol? We'll have the results after the break.
Yeah, the thing is, I mean, yeah, okay, it looks like you run 1/4 of a quarter mile in, one and a quarter mile in 2 minutes.
Back to Gerben,
I mean, that's McCracken, just so much.
McCracken.
Then it's Gunavera.
So much for so little. It's like all my girlfriends
say about
Dan.
And then comes J Boy's Echo Sonneteer. And on the inside comes Hence. And having pulled up out of the race here.
All right, we'll watch this in real time. But yeah, people get amped up. You know, the hats and the mint julep thing and. Sort of a like there's saddle, you know, people have Kentucky Derby parties at their house. You know, it's like a Super Bowl party. It's kind of neat.
Oh, we did one at my work a few years ago, like that Friday before the thing. You know, yeah, it's like a little niche thing. I mean, we talked about the, you know, Irish and St. Patrick's Day and Cinco de Mayo for, you know, these kind of cultures. This is like a culture, horse racing, even though, to be honest, other than this one and the other two that make up the Triple Crown, I don't really follow racing too much, even though Minnesota, you know, it's not like
we got Canterbury, we got Running Aces, we got two tracks right in the cities.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's kind of it's that niche thing, and I wish I knew more of it. I wish I could.
And down, now the stretch will come.
Behind as they come into the final furlong. Looking at Lee is making a bid now. Through on the inside, up into second. Always Dreaming with a 2.5 length lead of 16th to go.
That's what she said.
Looking at Lee is second. Then comes Battle of Midway, Classic Empire. They're coming to the line, and the dream comes true. Always Dreaming has won the Kentucky Derby. And it was Looking at Lee second.
Now, the most annoying thing about it is that he was a favorite. It's like, it's so boring. You want the 54-1 horse to pull through and hit it one time. Because no, what's the point of betting on the favorites? It's like betting on the Patriots win the Super Bowl every year. I mean, there's no fun in it.
Yeah, so I'm trying to think what was the number. Is 9-2 favorite?
Yeah.
So if you put in like, what, $50, you get like.
Oh, no. If you put up $2, you win 9.
Oh, well.
Yeah.
Interesting. Okay. So, yeah. So this is the first one. The Kentucky Derby always happens first. Then in a couple of weeks, I believe it's the. Sorry, I'm going to pull up right here. Triple Crown. Because, I mean, as I said, this is the first of our. This typically for horse racing, the first of three major races.
Mm-hmm.
So I believe the other ones are the Triple Crown racing here.
Yeah. Well, Preakness is next, and then it's the Belmont Stakes.
Belmont Stakes. Okay. Yeah. Okay. I always know of the Belmont. I always forget the Preakness.
All right. This is. We'll watch at the end here.
Three quarters of the length. Moob Tahij is off the rail, and now he's a length behind in second. An American.
Yeah, this is American Pharoah when he won the Triple Crown.
And here it is. The 37-year wait is over. American Pharoah is finally the one. American Pharoah has won.
Yeah. Because I always remember American Pharoah winning, even though for a long time I thought it was California Chrome. But apparently that jabroni didn't pull it off. Because Muggsy was born like an hour before this race.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
So, yeah, all the other years she's going to be watching Triple Crown because 37 years, I mean, that's a long spell. I don't think it's going to happen again anytime soon. And then she'd be like, the hell, man. Came into this world with a Triple Crown winner. Where's my second one?
Where's my second one?
Spoiled kids. I don't know about this new generation. All right, what's next?
Oh, right. A few weeks ago, I talked a little bit about... one of my favorite shows is coming back. Where in the World is Carmen Sandiego on Netflix.
Mm-hmm.
SNL did a sketch this past weekend. Where in the World is Kellyanne Conway, which is SNL obviously sticking with politics as usual because during the most craziest political times of the year. And one of my favorite characters, actresses Kate McKinnon,
mm-hmm.
doing an excellent impression of Kellyanne Conway.
Barking up the wrong tree there, Nick.
I think it's the right tree. I get what you're saying.
Yeah. Kate McKinnon likes the ladies.
Brought to you by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by viewers like you.
That's all. Like, SNL, and we're going to talk about Colbert here in a sec, still going extremely hard on politics. We're 100 days in, and I'm kind of bored with it.
I'll be bored by June. I think there's still stuff to... go on to, but this is going on a lot longer than the last couple election cycles, for obvious reasons.
Well, of course, because they're not going to criticize Obama.
I don't mind. I never mind when they did criticize him, and it should be fair, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. The biggest slam that SNL put on Obama was having The Rock play him in a sketch. It's like, The Rock, oh yeah, we'll watch that one next. Yeah. Yeah. Way to go. Yeah. Hammering.
Well, there was a...
weeks, no one knows where she is or what she's up to.
I love
Gumshoes,
her.
Gumshoes, your mission Zadim today is to answer Zabat. This question.
Where in the world is Kellyanne Conway?
I would be so pissed if I was not gonna call.
Was used to be on TV on like every single panel. The one day we all woke up and she was no longer there.
Yeah, Chris Pine.
What could have happened? She is not on any channel. Tell me where in the world is Kellyanne Conway?
Let's meet the Gumshoes who can help us find her.
He recently took a road trip across the country with his parents. He enjoys television and his friends. Meet Patrick Silva. And she once saw a lizard at the zoo. She loves computers and lunch. Meet Stephanie Melillo.
And here to help them solve the case, it's Acme senior agent Greg Lee.
Hey, Gumshoes, hope you're excited. Today's winner gets a trip for you and your mom to Sacramento. Now, are you guys ready to help us find Kellyanne Conway?
Well, we don't want to find her.
Okay, I guess that's our show.
Yeah. 7 weeks in a row, and no one wants to find that woman. In the world is
Kelly and Conway. That's pretty good.
Acapella about to start suing someone.
Oh, I, no, it's great promotion.
Oh, man. I was a big fan of that game show. It was really fun. I think the woman who, the black woman in the original one, I think just passed away.
Ah, the chief?
Yeah.
That's kind of sad.
Yeah.
Ah, I miss Jay Farrell.
You too.
Now, the reason I asked you all here is because we only have until the end of March to get something done in the Middle East. And that's hard to do when you, Senator Cotton, are sending letters to the Iranian government behind my back?
Yes, I did.
All right. Or when you, Speaker
nice.
Oh, my God, it's happening.
This must look weird live.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, I just wanted to remind you about dinner, Barack. Gentlemen, good luck.
Now, don't be alarmed. Barack Obama, much like Barack Obama, only larger and more violent. Now, where were we?
good impression.
You, Orange Man.
Me?
The Boehner,
you
not Trump.
Invite Netanyahu without asking?
I did, but...
You like Israel?
Yes.
Oh, maybe you should go visit Israel. You, Tom Cotton, come here.
Okay.
You write letter to Iran?
I did, yes, yeah.
You like writing letters?
I guess.
How you write letter when you have no hand?
Oh, oh God!
Watch this. Obama from downtown. Brick. Okay. You
yeah.
Go.
So, yeah. Really went hard after Obama.
No, the one I'm thinking of is the I'm Just a Bill one, yeah. Where they have Jay Farrell as the Rock. As Obama keep pushing the bill down the flight of stairs, and he talks about the executive order, That's probably the funniest sketch.
Oh yeah,
just keeps throwing him down the stairs, and Bobby Moynihan comes in as executive order. He just goes like, "I'm the executive order. I just make things happen." It just stops.
Yeah, Kean Thompson, underrated.
Under, would you say over?
Under. Extremely underrated.
Brand new episode of Schoolhouse Rock.
I'm just a bill.
Boy, you really have to climb a lot of steps to get to the...
Today's kids aren't going to know what this means. This sketch is about.
Say, what's that piece of paper doing here?
Oh, you mean me? I'll tell you who I am. I'm just a bill. Yes, I'm only a bill. And I'm sitting here on Capitol Hill. But I know I'll be a law someday. At least I hope and pray that I will. But today I am still just a bill.
Cool. What kind of bill are you?
Why, I'm an immigration bill. And one day the Republicans might create me so I could become a law.
And how does a bill become a law?
Funny you should ask. Well, first I go to the House and they vote on me. But then I need from the Senate a majority. And if I pass the legislative test, then I wind up on the president's desk. And I still...
Oh, Bob, it's sort of down the stairs.
We'll go with it. Ah, my legs. They were made of paper.
President Obama, what's the big idea? bill was trying to become a law.
I realize that. But you know, son, there's actually an even easier way to get things done around here. It's called an executive order.
I'm an executive order, and I pretty much just happened.
That's right.
And that's it. Wait a second. Don't you have to go through Congress at some point?
Oh, that's adorable. You still think that's how government works?
Don't listen to him, son. Look at the midterm elections. People clearly don't want this. I'm the black ass. I think I landed on my keys.
And this is from 2014.
Yep.
And it's sort of funny how it foreshadows Trump
now
and all of his executive orders. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. Oh, what's next?
All right. Final news story. A little bit of politics again here. Talk about the Late Show. Steve Colbert has made some news with the FCC. I think was giving him a little crap for kind of calling out the president. And yeah, that was pretty interesting.
And I understand, like, the joke that he dropped, and we'll get to here in a sec. Objectively, I think it's pretty damn funny. Like, it's my sort of sense of humor. But even on late night network television, I don't know.
In the network station, yeah, probably gone a little too far.
John Dickerson.
And I think, actually, I've been very consistent. You know, it's very funny when the fake media goes out, you know, which we call the mainstream media, which sometimes I must say is you. But when the
you
fake
mean me personally, or
your show, I love your show. I call it Deface the Nation.
Really? Donald Trump, John Dickerson is a fair-minded journalist and one of the most competent people who will ever walk into your office, and you treat him like that? Now, John Dickerson has way too much dignity to trade insults with the president of the United States to his face. But I, sir, am no John Dickerson. And when you, okay, all right, let me introduce you to something we call the Tiffany way. When you insult one member of the CBS family, you insult us all. Bazinga. All right?
Okay.
Here we go. All right?
Get the gloves off.
Mr. Trump, your presidency, I love your presidency. I call it Disgrace the Nation. You're not the POTUS, you're the BLOTUS. You're the glutton with the button. You're a regular Gorge Washington. You're the president, but you're turning into a real pricktator. Sir, you attract more skinheads than free Rogaine. You have more people marching against you than cancer. You talk like a sign language gorilla who got hit in the head. In fact, the only thing your mouth is good for is being Vladimir Putin's holster.
That was the one. Yeah, implying that, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yes, he said that.
I mean, it's a funny joke. I laughed the first time I heard it. But yeah, implying that the president is, sort of taken in the mouth from president of a foreign nation. I could see why people would be upset because of the vulgarness or perhaps the homophobicness of it. I don't really see it, but I could see how they could see it like that. I thought it was a good joke, but you know, he's not gonna get fired over it, even though that was trending, because I feel like companies and people are starting to realize, like, oh, internet outrage, that's the default mode. Like, if they're not outraged or insulted or about something, then you're doing something wrong.
Yeah, I completely agree with that.
Yeah. And then there's the news.
The news with Uncle Nick.
From the entire Channel 4 news team, I'm Veronica Corningstone.
And I'm Ron Burgundy. Go f*** yourself, San Diego.
All right, Nick, what you got going on this beautiful Monday?
I think I'm going out to happy hour after work. Pretty excited for that. Catching up with some old coworkers, and then going out for dinner, drinks that night. See some podcasting stuff.
Oh yeah. If you're out and about and you listen to us on a Monday, Doogie from the Scoop 1500 ESPN will be out at Gabe's on the Park at 7, recording up a show. Stop on by, say hi. to Nick.
Say hi to me.
Yeah, do that up. And also, hey, if you're getting out and about with friends and coworkers, family, etc., Pedal Pub is where it's at. Get around town in the Twin Cities area and, yeah, have some fun. Get some sun on your face. Have a couple of cold beverage while they do the driving and stop by some great Twin Cities bars, watering holes, etc. Oh, you can turn to a foodie tour. Eat Street in Uptown, do that up. They got lots of routes, whether you're downtown Minneapolis, St. Paul, Uptown, Northeast, anywhere you want to go in the Twin Cities. They probably got you hooked up. Pedalpub.com for all the details. Lots of fun. You know, we're doing it for my birthday, or you could do it for a bachelorette party. I just saw some pictures on Instagram. Bachelorette party's doing that up, so hit it up while the weather's good before winter is coming. Winter is coming. Such a stupid show.
Coming out in July. Shut up.
Nah, that is all. Also, if you enjoy the show, spread the word. Add to the Jerome Homie Army iTunes, Stitcher, iHeartRadio. Check out YouTube as well. Putting up some stuff on there. Helter Skelterly. Yeah. Check out the Purple for the Win YouTube. Actually doing videos on that pretty much over there. And thanks, producer Allie Jerome Sorensen, for making us not sound so stupid today. But for Nick, I'm Andy Carlson, Nick and Young. Sayonara and bye-bye. We'll talk to you tomorrow.
Thanks for listening to Bull with Andy Carlson, Minnesota's 87th best daily podcast. Download the show on iTunes. Everyone's middle name is Jerome.